Good day, and welcome to the PTC India Limited Investor Meet. At this moment, all participants are in the listen-only mode. Later, we will conduct a question-and-answer session. At that time, you may click on the Q&A tab on the left-hand side of your panel to ask an interactive or a text question. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand over the proceedings to Mr. Deepak Amitabh, Chairman and Managing Director of PTC India Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Moderator Zab. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the management team of PTC, I welcome you all to the conference call to discuss the results of Q4 2021 and annual results of the company. Before I begin my dialogue, it's very important for me to introduce my team members to all of you. Many of them are known faces, and there will be one unknown face also. First, I'll introduce Dr. Rajiv Mishra. He can wave his hand. He's the Director of Marketing and Business Development, whom you all have been seeing for quite some time. Then another veteran which we have is Mr. Rajiv Malhotra, Executive Director and CRO. Then we also wanted to introduce Mr. Harish Sharan, who is Executive Director, Commercial and Operations. And then Mr. Pankaj Goel, who has been the Chief Financial Officer for so many years. Now, we have strengthened our investor relations team, which is now represented by Mr. Sushant Chaturvedi, who is a new face for PTC, though an old veteran of the industry, and Mr. Anand Kumar, who has been interacting with you all. So before I get into my own dialogue I'll request Sushant Chaturvedi, who is appearing for the first time on behalf of PTC, to give few brief lines about himself. Thank you, Sushant.
Good afternoon, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. All those people who have joined here today on the occasion of our web call, which we have organized today, to discuss our results. Thank you very much for being present here today. I wish and pray that all of you stay safe in these current times of, going through the pandemic. And we hope that the third wave, which we are talking about, would be far, far more moderate than what we have encountered so far. So just to give you a brief background about myself, my name is Sushant Chaturvedi. I have been a career investment banker for over two decades, close to 24 years, having worked with several large organizations like Allianz, ILFS, HSBC, Avendus, and Publicis. I've had very close interaction with the investor community, not only in India, but globally. We've had the pleasure of, going out on several no-deal roadshows with the chairman as well in my capacity as a banker. I have been involved with PTC for close to 15 years, having been involved in the initial QIP of what we did for PTC and then for PFS. So thank you for having me over, sir, and giving me the opportunity to interact with all the investor community. We look forward to your continued support and patronage in helping us grow further. We have planned some very interesting initiatives going forward, which you will get to know in due course of time. And I hope to continue to get your support and cooperation in making this this year a landmark year for us. Thank you, sir. Over to the chairman.
Thank you, Sushant. So this time, we are changing the format also slightly in this interaction which we are going to have. So after my initial short remarks, this time I am going to ask my Director of Marketing and Business Development, Dr. Mishra, to elaborate on certain issues which are very relevant to understand the power sector and the power market in this country. So just to begin with, during the quarter, our volume recorded an all-round growth led by short-term trades. The catch-up of economic activity lost during the COVID time has been the biggest driver for this increase in the short-term trades in the last quarter. The uncertainty in demand has manifested in the growth reported in the shorter tenor segments, of the contracts as COVID still poses a challenge to their life and livelihood. We have just gone through the second wave of COVID-19. Lesser said it is better. But what also we saw during the last quarter, Q4 of 2021, good fiscal intervention by the central government for demand creation happened. Budgetary focus was there on spending, development of industrial infrastructure, etc., which have played a substantial role in keeping the electricity demand firm, not only in the Q4, but in the going forward, even if we are hit by the second wave also. But we can see a lot of things happening because of those steps taken by Government of India in Q4 21. And the consistent key benchmark rates of RBI have helped drive industrial activity in this tough year also. Now, I'll not talk about the figures, etc., which you all must have seen and analyzed since the time we declared the result. But just I wanted to emphasize that the growth in business has been due to our ability to adapt to change and continue delivering services, exploring business opportunity. This has been the key to maintaining our leadership position. This year, we have seen a full term, almost a full year of real-time market. I'll not get into director marketing will cover these areas. But the availability of this product for energy planning closer to the consumption window is also providing traction to our energy portfolio activities, which again will be covered by Dr. Amishra. And there have been many policy changes also contemplated by Ministry of Power during the year, including MBED, market coupling, new tariff policy, etc., which would have an impact on the evolution of power market and business. We also continue to make significant progress in rendering innovative solutions to various market participants, thereby strengthening our engagement and positioning with various parts of the value chain or the ecosystem, whatever we have said that. And PTC is committed towards investment in its people and systems to build capabilities and drive solutions. I'm confident that these investments which we are doing, some of which you must have seen yesterday when we reported certain things to the stock exchanges about certain acquisitions also, these are a small way to drive our future prospects and position to grow and prosper in future. So now with this opening remarks, I am going to request my Director of Marketing, Dr. Rajiv Mishra, to take us along on business done during the last year by the company. And I will be, if required, I'll intervene at a shorter intervals also if required. Thank you very much. Dr. Mishra.
Thank you, sir. And good afternoon, everybody. The year which has just gone by is a year which will be always remembered in history for its uncertainty. So was the case with the power supply, trading, and the service to the customer. But let me tell you, it is a really pleasure moment for us meeting our investors and informing you that we have created a record by trading 80 billion units this year, which is almost 21% higher than the volume traded last year. When we met you all during last investor conference, there was question that whether we can meet even what we have supplied or traded in the last year. But it is really something which is a pleasure for both you and us that we have surpassed the expectation by almost now 21%. Now, a little bit of uncertainty will always bring some of the changes in the portfolio. And that's the reason what you have seen. But after the completion of the year, I can say that we remained at 50% supply from long-term, medium-term, and cross-border. And 50% of it is on a shorter term, both in terms of bilateral short-term plus exchanges. Now, as I mentioned that it was a year of uncertainty, so was the demand. And it kept on fluctuating at different quarters. And to meet the near-term supply demand shortage, the shorter term was opted or preferred by the customers. We made ourselves customized to the solution which was required by the customer, and we could meet their requirement in whatever form and format they wanted to get it supplied. The most important thing which I would like to share with you all is the real-time market was introduced on 1st of June 2020. It was a new product. Internationally, this real-time market is called intraday market. And we were not very customized to this kind of a market because it is a shorter version of the advanced planning. But it is again a pleasure to tell you that PTC in this segment has almost completed or almost served 44% of the total volume, which is substantial, keeping this as a new product. And we have done almost 9.7 billion units total. That is, Exchange has done it. And we have done almost 4 billion units of RTM, real-time market. And we have supplied it to most of the large utilities and customers, this product. So what Chairman has just mentioned, that we have adapted ourselves for this product, and we were the first to supply. Let me proudly announce it, that PTC was the first company which started the RTM product in the first day of, on 1st June. And after the completion of almost 9 months, we were the largest in doing this trading as well. Now, you all have always asked that the long-term, medium-term, how PTC is going to perform. We could schedule more in terms of long-term and medium-term. Particularly, the cross-border have seen a rise with the supply commencement of Mangdeshu for the entire year. And that has given a lot of increase. And we have increased the cross-border or the long-term more than 5 billion units in the last year. Sir, if you would like to add something here before I switch to the newer products. Sir, unmute yourself, sir.
Just to summarize, two, three things I just want to reemphasize. The prices on the exchange also became lucrative, incentivizing these utilities to shift their mode of procurement. Second thing about the RTM, when he talked about, that shows PTC's preparedness, market responsiveness. That's a very important thing which I wanted to highlight. And also, we did green term, I had GTM trades also we did. That's the second one which was started, we did, we are present there also. And third thing which I just wanted to reemphasize, that despite an year where the power exchange volume dominated the portfolio, 50% of our trading volume still came from medium and large term. So in a portfolio of 80 billion unit, 40 billion unit came from sustained profitable businesses. And that shows the results, etc., that gets reflected in the results. Thank you.
So to continue from there, one area which we are always we have always mentioned in our annual results is the retail or the large industrial consumers. We have not lost our sight in this area. Of course, 1 megawatt and above customers are always known as the open access customers. We have focused more on the large industrial consumers, which themselves are consuming more than 100, 200 megawatts of electricity, and they themselves is good enough to be called as a utility. So in this year, we have added many number of large industrial consumers, and we are keeping our focus on this, not only in terms of supplying power, in terms of trading, but giving them advice in the area of energy management, consultancy, advisory, energy efficiency, because these are all linked areas, and any customer who comes in our fold is also looking forward to PTC for this kind of solutions as well. So our focus is very much there. These are a potential star customers who can convert into a real business in years to come. And we have not lost our focus in this area. The area which was always a focus area for us, it was the consultancy and advisory area, and we have kept you all informed about this area. In consultancy area, we have mentioned about the energy efficiency solutions, including project management units for their large projects for ESL, then port and the SEZ distribution areas. We have done this year, Paradeep as a new portfolio, which has been come into our fold. MPA KVN has been given back to us for another 3 years. Then many other ports and large SEZs are coming to our fold. As and when it comes to our fold, we will inform you. So the total order value for these consultancy and advisory services has reached to a very significant number, that is 200 crores, out of which we have clocked 29 crore plus for as a revenue for this financial year. And we are also trying to go into or into some niche areas like energy portfolio management solutions, transmission and GIS on AIS advisory services, the express feeders for large industrial consumers. So these are some of the consultancy area, engineering consultancy area, which we were doing, but we are getting new contracts. Particularly, we have got a new contract for Talcher fertilizers, and that is substantial, 5 crore plus order for the engineering consultancy. So these are some of the areas which we were focusing in the past. This is still a growth area for us, and we expect that this will continue to grow each year. At this point of time, you would like to inform to the investors our new acquisition, what we are trying to do, or should I continue?
Just here, I will just like to re-emphasize on the two important things which Dr. Mishra has spoken about. One is retail being a new growth driver, and second was consultancy and advisory. Regarding the retail being a new growth driver, I just want to say that we were a B2B player, and we are now transitioning from B2C player portfolio. And world over, we have seen the value associated with B2C is quite always high. And now we have started to go along this path. So that was regarding the first point which he touched upon. And about the consultancy and advisory, whatever he has stated, that this is an area of key focus for us. It has shown a 20% growth in the operational income. And we are looking to scale this further. It is also a strategy to diversify our business model to include non-regulated revenue streams also. So on one side, we have the trading business, etc., which we have been doing. And this is another stream which we had started some time back. And now with the what Dr. Mishra is going to say and why did he make all these acquisitions, etc., are going to add to this new non-regulated revenue streams. Thank you, Dr. Mishra. Please go ahead.
The important issue in our consultancy and advisory business is, again, energy portfolio management. Although we have mentioned that the new products and the new regulations are allowing new products which are nearer to the dispatch. When I say nearer to the dispatch, that means you have limited time to decide which product is useful in your power procurement portfolio. So that it can give you the maximum benefit from the market. So till now, most of the utilities, DISCOMs, they were using their gut feeling to decide what should be their procurement strategy. But with time, it has been seen that you need to plan it better, and to plan it better, you need to forecast better, and to forecast better, you need to have scientific tools to support your decision making. And that's what exactly we have in our mind when we feel that. And now from now onwards, we are trying to make it more a technology-driven advisory in energy portfolio management solution. And very soon, we would like to inform you that we are hiring people from the industry who are specialists in this area. And we are trying to create a niche or a strategic business unit within the company for the technology support to support the customers and to support the internal functions in the company. So very important step, but at this point of time, I may not be in a position to share you more details, But certainly, as and when it happens, we will come back to you and inform you more on this. Very important question which you people always ask, and I would like to inform you also, that we are the nodal agency for, or the aggregator for the pilot 2, which was where the price discovery was done last year in the month of February. Because of the corona period, although there was a very good response initially from all the utilities, but as because there was a dip in demand, the final signing of the PPA PSA could not happen last year. Now we have reached to a stage that we have a confirmed 1070 megawatt of PPA PSA, which we are going to sign shortly with the states, and we expect much more to come maybe in a couple of days more, because there is now there is a rise in prices both in exchanges and RTM, and there is also increase in demand in the pan India because of this summer. So keeping all this, we are keeping our fingers crossed that we will be getting more orders beyond 1070 megawatt. Sir, you would like to add here something before I switch over to the new products? Sir, unmute yourself, please.
We successfully did the pilot one scheme, and now we are well positioned for the pilot 2. And this highlights our strength as a solution provider to even naughty problems of standard assets. That's what I wanted to say. Thank you. Please go ahead.
Now, there are two very important products, or I say very interesting products, which Ministry of Power is now trying to launch. And one is the MBED, and the second is the, if not a product, but it is the concept of market coupling. Both are positive bearing on PTC. When we analyze our portfolio, if you allow us, I can explain what is the concept of MBED. MBED is a concept where the scheduling of all the power other than the hydro and renewable will be done at a national level through a price discovery mechanism, and the least cost variable supply should be preferred, or would be preferred, to supply first, and then subsequently the pecking order will be decided. So this is a concept which they are trying to, Ministry of Power is trying for long, but they have given a date from 1st April 2022. MBED will be for phase one, they will introduce it. But we have analyzed our portfolio, and it is pleasure to inform everybody that we have, after considering our portfolio of long term or medium term, we can easily say that MBED within PTC portfolio as it is existing today, we are going to get benefit of MBED even if we are not looking the product in a larger perspective. In the current scenario also, we are going to get the benefit of it. But of course, MBED will bring a lot of opportunities for a trader like PTC, which has a dominant position in driving the market and utilizing this product better. So as far as MBED is concerned, this will be helpful for us. And that's what we have analyzed, and we can mention it in this conference. Second is the very important aspect of market coupling. Right now, there are two exchanges which are operating in the country, IEX and PXIL, and both are discovering their prices every day on a separate platform, and the prices are not same. To implement MBED and also to give a uniform prices for all the buyers and sellers in the exchange, I think the market coupling will be very useful. And in the PMR 21, the regulator has clearly mentioned that it is to be implemented on a date which regulator feels it should be notified. So that is also going to help us not only in our present business, but maybe the third exchange which we have proposed. And it is again a matter of pleasure for me to tell that finally the regulator CERC has given a go ahead on May 12 to create this platform. And this is going to, again, a new platform with no legacy. When I say no legacy, when you are working in a platform for last 12, 13 years, naturally you would like to defend some products where you are dominant, but you would not like to introduce some products where you are not dominant. So this Pranurja, the new exchange, has no legacy, and it has a strong backing from three of the very strong promoters, that is PTC India Limited, Bombay Stock Exchange, and ICICI Bank. And with an open and an innovative mind, we feel that a robust technology is going to help this exchange also to perform very well. Most important thing is with the market coupling, it will get an opportunity to be at parity with other exchanges which are working for quite some time now. Sir, anything you would like to add before I move on to the last part of my...
No, I think I'm fine with that. Whatever you explain.
There is one deal which we have concluded recently, which was informed to the stock exchanges yesterday. And it is, again, augmentation of the portfolio of our advisory and consulting services. And not going into very deep details because of the reasons which you all know, but this is going to give impetus to growth of our advisory business. And we will be acquiring not only the businesses under the FS Energy Solutions, but also we would be getting the capacity and capability or the talent source resources along with this transfer. So this is going to help us in a longer run. Two important things which is part of the presentation which CFO will make, that the provision related to PL and provision related to the capital toward the some advances, some registration charges for the land. We would like to inform you that we are cautious and we try to evaluate our portfolio very carefully. So these provisions are done just on to be cautious on our assets. The second part, because after COVID period, we don't require a large office spaces, and the board decided that it has to be the current spaces what we have and we are operating from is good enough. So it was decided. So these provisions are done cautiously, and I think CFO will be in a better position to explain when we'll be explaining the deeper details of these two provisions in the accounts. But management has done due diligence before doing all the provisions what we have made in this financial year. Sir, I'm done with the briefing. Sir, if you want to say something before I can hand it over to CFO.
No, thank you very much. I think you have covered all the aspects very, very, very clearly. Now I'll request Pankaj Goyal, our CFO, to upload the presentation and talk about the financial numbers.
Thank you, CMD. Thank you, Director of Marketing, and good evening to all. So as much as already been explained by the Chairman Sir and the Director of Marketing regarding our products, our services, the trading volumes and all other things, but just because we have already uploaded the presentation also in the last evening, but I'll go through the major highlights for this quarter and for the financial year FY21. Next. Yeah. So as you can see on the first slide, first I'll explain the Q4 results of FY21 on a standalone basis. As you can see, the volume has increased from 12 billion units to 16 billion units during this quarter. That is why there is a growth of 36%. And there are various products under which the volume has increased. Let's say like in short term bilateral, the volume has increased from 464 million to 1577 million units. And in the exchange, the volume has increased from 4.4 million units to 7.6 million units. And in the long term and medium term, the trading volume more or less remains the same. That is packed around at 7 billion units. As regards the trading margin, that is the pure difference between the sale and purchase of the power. So the trading margin has increased from 42.99 crore to 53.67 crore during the quarter. As regards the trading income, including the rebate part, has increased from 73.66 crore to 79.69 crore during this quarter. And as regards the total operational income, the total operational income, when we say, so it takes account the trading margin, rebate, the surcharge and the consultancy income. So on a totality basis, the total operational income has increased from 124.81 crore to 202.41 crore. That is why there is a growth of 62% during this quarter. And as regards consultancy income, the consultancy income during this quarter has gone up from 6 crore to 9 crore. Now, as you can see the slide on the trading margin per unit, so the per unit has also gone from 9.9 paisa per unit to 11.88 paisa per unit during this quarter. As regards the profit before tax, so profit before tax has increased from 86 crore to 108 crore. That is, there is an increase of 23%. And the PAT has remained at the same level of around 64 crore. And the total comprehensive income has also remained at the same level of around 64 crores. Next. Now you can see I'll go through the full year results of the.
Sorry for intervention. Sir. Can you go back to the last slide, previous slide?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. When you said that your PBT has changed from 86 crore to 106 crores, why the PAT remained same, flat? Because of tax return, please explain. Yeah, just tell here.
Yes, sir. As you can see that PBT has increased, you are rightly in saying so, sir. PBT has increased by 23%. But in real term, you will say because the PAT has remained at the same level, the reason is that we have taken, as Director Marketing has also explained, we have taken the provision in the impairment of our carrying value of the PTC Energy investment. And there is a 10 crore provision for our land, which we have taken this thing. So on this both, there is a provision of 60 crore. And in both the things, the tax expenses are not allowed. So accordingly, the tax ratio has increased. Because on this 60 crore, if in a normal sense, if we get a tax expense of 25%, then the PAT must be much higher that way. So this is the reason that PAT has remained at the same level.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. So, sir, now I'll go through the standalone result for the full financial year of PTC India Limited, sir. So, in the first slide on the top, you can see the graph of the volume, the comparison between the current year and the last year volume growth. So, you'll see that you remember that in the last year, in the first quarter, there was the COVID impact was there. And our volume has just on a quarter to quarter basis had remained at the same level of around at 19 billion. But after that quarter, the PTC India has picked up. And on a quarter to quarter basis, you can see that the difference is there. Like, for example, in quarter two, our volume has increased from 21 billion to 26 billion. In quarter three, our volume has increased from 13 billion to 18 billion units. And on quarter four basis, for which we are sitting now, has increased from 12 billion unit to 16 billion unit. And on totality basis, there is a volume growth of 21% for the full financial year. That is, the volume has grown from 66 billion unit to 80 billion unit. And as regards the volume mix for the full year, I can explain you that the short term volume has in the total portfolio has increased from 44% to 50%, and long term and medium term taken together has slightly decreased from 56% to 50%. Next, please. Yeah, as you can see that trading margin, as regards the trading margin for the full financial year has increased from 241 crore to 336 crore during this year. And as regards the trading income, including the rebate part, it has increased from 358 crore to 431 crore. And as regards trading margin, one thing I would like to highlight that this is the first time that our trading margin, that is the pure difference between the sale and purchase, we have first time crossed over 300 crore as far as the trading margin is concerned. As regards the consultancy income, it has also gone up from 24.5 crore to 29.3 crore during this year. And the total operational income, I mean to say that taking together all trading margin, the rebate income, the surcharge income, the total operational income has gone up from 542 crore to 728 crore. That is why there is a growth of 34%. And there is another one landmark which PTC has achieved in this year. That is first time we have crossed over 700 crore of total operational income. Next slide. As regards the total margin per unit, the margin per unit has increased from 7.8 paisa to 8.73 paisa during this year, and the profit before tax has increased from 422.53 crore to 565.57 crore. That is, there is a growth of 34%. And again, there is one milestone that first time PTC has crossed over 500 crore of PPT in this year. And likewise, the PAT has also increased from 320 crore to 410 crore. And there is a growth of 28% in the PAT. And again, this is the first time that PTC has crossed 400 crore of PAT. So likewise, the total comprehensive income has also gone in the same direction, that it has increased from 320 crore to 410 crore. And balance is the highlights, which you can go through because we have uploaded already this presentation. So that is from my side, sir. I have presented the major highlights of this financial year. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much. Now, I think we have made our points and discussions, etc. And it's always an interactive session. So I'll request now for the Q&A to start.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. To ask an interactive question, please click on the Q&A tab on the left side of the panel and click on Raise Hand button. The operator will announce your name when it is your turn to ask a question. Please accept the prompt on your screen and unmute your microphone while proceeding with your question. To ask a text question, you may click on the text tab available on the top on clicking the Q&A tab and type your question. Participants connected on telephone line are requested to enter star and one to ask a question. We will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is a text-only question from the line of Jay Mehta from KSA Shares and Securities. Which states are showing good recovery in demand and participation in short-term market?
Mishra?
The states where the COVID cases are less are the states where recovering faster. Particularly if you see the second wave, it started from the Western India, it came to Northern India, and then it went to eastern part of the country. So the western states are now recovering well, and Maharashtra, Gujarat, and the northern part of the country also is having a good demand, particularly Punjab, Haryana, where the paddy season has started. The demand is coming well. Now UP is also recovering and recovering well. So all the northern states and western states are doing well. South, before the COVID was drawing a lot, because the summer started a little bit earlier there. So South was doing well, and it was not affected too much by COVID this time, but particularly the West was affected and it recovered the first.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question. The next question is an audio and video question from the line of Vijay Sarda from Cressida. Please go ahead. Please accept the prompt on your screen and proceed with your question. Mr. Sarda, please go ahead with your question. As there is no response from the current participant, we'll move on to the next question. From the line of Mohit Kumar from DAM Capital, please go ahead. Please accept the prompt on your screen and proceed with your question.
Am I audible?
Yes, Mohit.
Yeah. Good evening, sir.
And congratulations on good set of numbers, and especially in this very tough environment. Sir, I have two questions, sir. First, on the if you can throw some light on the where are we in terms of, you know, stake sale in PTC Energy or you know, PTC Financial Services. And secondly, you just spoke about this the B2C business and consultancy. I just want to get the sense of, you know, where are we in terms of B2C and what are we trying to achieve. I just
sorry, if you can repeat your second question.
My second question is in B2C market, what are we trying to do exactly? And in consultancy, what is our big vision? Where are we looking? What are the kind of numbers you're looking at, you know, 3 to 4 years down the line? And what kind of capabilities we acquired from acquiring this ILFS, you know, energy solution, which was not there earlier with us?
Thank you. Just to give a summary about this ILFS deal, this is a small bolt-on acquisition that is funded through internal accruals. And secondly, it is EPC accretive, despite being a very small amount, which we are going to pay. So obviously our biggest gain is the increase in competencies through the acquisition of skilled man, human resources, credentials, and the knowledge of acquiring an executive consulting contract. So which Dr. Mishra also elaborated, I'm just rephrasing the words. And we believe that this year we did 30 crores. Obviously, we can't talk about future projections in a this thing, but the market is very large. And to get into 3 digits also should not take many, much more time. That's what I can say. Second thing, which you have asked for, that the regarding PTC Energy Limited, the process is on. However, it is taking slightly more time than anticipated, because given the uncertainty in the business environment created by the state DISCOMs position on renewables. So Andhra Pradesh, which we thought that in 2 years or 3 years it should be sorted out, has still not been sorted out. And other changes, and not in the least the cycle of pandemic outbreaks and abatements in various geographies. So, but the one thing which I wanted to make it clear, that it is not only we are confident along with the rest of the developers who are present in that state, that the sanctity of the contract will be honored. And we have our taking a provision is a proactive and prudent step to account for the current business context. That's all. It's more of just a prudence. And we believe, along with all the developers who are present in Andhra Pradesh, that the long-term contract, which we have entered totally after the due process of law and regulatory confirmations, will stand. But because of that, some delays which have been happening. Thank you. And so I have answered to both the questions, but if anyone wants, and also for my team wants to add, please go ahead. And regarding your B2B and B2C, see, Rajiv, Dr. Mishra itself said that open access customers, he has been catering for quite some time. And with all the other things which are happening, he sees a much more traction coming in future, change in the market design, the concept which we have already talked about, PTC business model or virtual reality, etc. All those things we can see are now the gap is in decreasing. So that's what I wanted to say. Thank you.
So last question, sir. Where are we in terms of, you know, launching our third exchange? What is the timeline we are looking at?
Dr. Mishra, you can answer this question. What steps we have taken? See, timelines, yeah. So it is, timelines is one thing which become, we should not give a futuristic statement or such, but then what are the steps which you have taken and how do you see that things are going to turn out? Thank you.
Mohit, we are very, three very critical steps which are required for the operationalization of the exchange. Couple of the milestones the company has already achieved. They have already appointed the head of the business. They have already identified the new office complex where they are going to start their operation. They have already appointed an international consultant to do the due diligence for technology. And they have also identified the labs on which the platforms will be tested. So these are a couple of things which are very critical, and already some of the tests they have started. So after the achieving the or getting the nod from the regulator, these steps are in the direction to operationalize it as early as possible. And when there will be a major progress in this area, we'll come back to you and we'll inform you more.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Best of luck. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is an audio and video question from the line of Dhruv Muchhal from HDFC AMC. Please go ahead. Please accept the prompt on your screen and proceed with your question.
Hello. Thank you so much. Sir, a few questions. Apologies, I was a bit late in the call, so probably it could be a repeat of your opening remarks. But sir, if I look at the core margins, which is basically if I've reduced the surcharge income from your Q4 numbers, Q4 rebate, I'm reducing the surcharge income also in the rebate. I get a number which is lower than your the run rate. I mean, you had a very strong run rate in terms of margins X of surcharge income for the first 9 months. But it seems to have dipped significantly in the fourth quarter. So just wanted to understand, and the mix of sales is similar. The mix of volumes are similar. So just wanted to understand what is driving this. Were there some one-offs in the previous quarter or something? Yeah.
Certainly. See, this quarter especially, I mean, Dr. Mishra, while he was giving his this thing, he said that Q4, when the market, after the first wave, and the market just started opening up suddenly, and the prices were low, so a lot of buyings, etc., were done at the exchanges, where the margins are much lesser than what it is in the bilateral market segment or the medium term and long term. So that may have been the reason. This is what I understand, but Dr. Mishra and Pankaj Goyal can add value to this particular proposition.
Sir, you are very, very right in saying that if you see the mix, there are slightly, in quarter four, there is a jump in the shorter term trade, which is almost 88% compared to the previous year. So, because that is again, because of the uncertainty in the demand coming back again on the market. So COVID has created uncertainty in the fall of the demand, and it has created uncertainty when it was picking up also. So the most of the DISCOMs have not tied up their power for the fourth quarter, and they were trying to get the demand met through the exchanges. And you have rightly pointed out, sir, in the exchanges, the margin is lesser compared to the bilateral trade, and that's the reason why there is some aberrations here. But overall for the year, if you see, this aberrations were evened out, and there was no impact of this aberration in the quarter four.
Thank you.
I'd like to answer the second part of it. What was the reason for the surcharge in the fourth quarter? Sir, as we all aware that in the first quarter of this financial year, last financial year, 2021, there was a COVID period and utilities are not coming forward for reconciliation, because as per the accounting policy, surcharge has to be recognized only on the certainty basis when you are confirmed and the utility does the reconciliation. So actually first half of the year has gone towards the managing the reconciliation part and all that. So that is why when we completed the reconciliation in the later part of the year, so surcharge becomes certain and we could book that surcharge on received basis in our book. And plus the government of India has also announced the Atmanirbhar and all that, so that the money states are receiving in the last quarter only. So that is why the effort of the, I will say, of the first half or up to the 9 months has shown the results in the Q4. So that is the reason for increase in the surcharge last quarter of it.
Got it. So just referring to the comments that you made, so if I look at the full year volumes, almost 50% of volumes have come from short term versus last year it was about 44%. So there is an increase in your short term volumes, and I believe this would largely be due to exchanges. In that context, your full year core margins have also improved. despite the increase in short-term volumes. So I just wanted to understand what, then what is driving the full year trading margins? This trading margins. I'm excluding for the surcharge income.
So see what happens. That's what I said in my remarks. I mean that when Dr. Mishra was giving and when I was summing up, see, even short-term is 50%, but the because of increase of volume from 66 billion to 80 billion, 50% still came from medium-term and long-term, where margins are much, much better. So therefore, overall, if you see, we are 4 plus, even if you just remove those surcharges, etc., there is still 4 paise plus margin for the whole year.
Yeah, that's true. So that is what I was trying to understand. So on a blended basis, it should, considering that the short term has increased, which is relatively lower than your medium term and long term, your overall margins just on a trend basis should have been lower than the FY20 number. So what I'm trying to understand is, see, sir, for last many years, what was happening, your core margins were declining on a per paisa basis, were declining if I exclude the surcharge income. This is the first year that that trend has changed. And this is despite an increase in the short term market share, which is against the trend, typically against the trend. So yeah, that is what I'm trying to understand, what's driving this.
See, maybe, I mean, I don't know that, but we don't want to get into the details, etc., which we can, you can do one-on-one discussion at any point of time. But there may be some opportunities where you could make some more margin than normally we are able to do. So opportunities, as and when there arises for a short term also, PTC team must be geared up to keep using the opportunity. That's what I can say.
Okay. I actually wanted to understand some trend, and probably I will take that later on a one-on-one basis.
Yeah, offline. Yeah. We can have a discussion. Yeah.
Sure.
Thank you.
And sir, so just one more question was, if I look at the way you're managing the balance sheet now, it seems interesting that you have started to look at borrowings as a route to fund the business. Say, for example, last 3 years back, it was about zero. Now it is about 900 odd crores. At the same time, your working capital is broadly the same. So the borrowing as a share of working capital, net working capital, which is trade receivables minus payables, has increased. Which seems a decent way to, you know, run the business given the nature of your business. So, sir, in that context, I wanted to understand, how do you see at the payout or the use of cash going forward? Because say, for example, this year you have paid 50%, but given that you are using borrowings as a decent route to fund your working capital now, how do you see the use of cash and the way you probably increase dividends, or any thoughts that you can share on the use of this cash?
As on today, it will be very difficult to talk about the cash flow, how the cash flow fans out this year. But normally, you have seen that we have been rewarding the shareholders, and whatever basic minimum we have stated, we never had a policy for so many years. Last year, we came out with a dividend policy of at least 50% PAT to be given. And I remember the moment we had announced, January or February, and then after that, the COVID had impacted us. And there was so much of uncertainty. But having committed, we believe that capital allocation is going to be playing a very, very important role, which you have seen in last couple of years we have started doing. And this trend will continue going forward also. I can't talk about, see, the money which is there, one is managing the working capital, but also managing the larger volumes and the revenues also, which is also increasing. Like this time, I think I'll leave the question to Pankaj Goel, who can explain in a much better way that what was the total rupees-wise sale which he did, and with the same capital, etc., he has to manage these things also. So volumes are increasing, the revenue has also increased. So Pankaj, can you help me out, because these are financial figures, you can help in explaining the questions.
That is the very interesting question which has been asked. And I think the very deep analysis of our balance sheet has been done, and we are delighted to answer, sir. And as regards the volume, you have already rightly saying so, sir. The against 66 billion, we have done 80 billion. So in rupee term, it converts into, that means the last year we have done a turnover of around 23,000 crore, and this year we have done a turnover of around 26,500 crore. So there is around an increase of 3,000 crore of turnover in value terms only. So for managing, let's say if we take a working capital debtor minus creditor, if we take a total working capital of, let's say 40 days, so it means that much of working capital is also required for managing the additional 3000 crore rupees. So by managing this, and the second thing which I wanted to highlight on the capital side, that in perspective of that question, that it depends on the capacity of the payment of the utility also. Let's say this year we are able to get good amount of money from the utilities, and the out of the total borrowing, it has been rightly said that we are managing on around 500 crore on a basis of 3 years on an average. But it depends, the cash utilization is much dependent on the payment which we receive from the utilities and the onward payment to the generators also. So you are rightly saying so, sir. So depending on the volume increase, that how much volume will be increased from 80 million or so and in the years to come, how much, what will be the paying capacity of the customers and the we will pay to the generators also. So considering all these cases, scenarios, naturally the company will decide it's the amount of the dividend, and but as per the dividend policy, we have already defined that 50% of the profits which we have to distribute as a dividend.
Got it. So can I ask one more question? I had one question more.
Yeah.
So this was on the RTC volumes. So is it possible to share firstly what is the volume of RTC that you did this year, and how much is that contributing to growth? And so I also wanted to understand on the sustainability of these volumes. Just a conceptual point was, RTC is a last resort market where DISCOMs I thought will not rely largely because the prices can fluctuate significantly, and if they continue to rely on this, it can probably hurt them at a future point, given it's a last resort market and the prices can spike like anything. This year probably was a good year because there was a lot of oversupply. But if do you think this on a structural basis, this can continue, this RTC trend? Because RTC earlier was thought as a replacement to the DSM market. But when we look at the trend, the DSM is not replaced, but the RTC has increased. So it seems an additional volume on the DSM market. So, but probably this is driven by the oversupply in the market. So just wanted to understand, how do you look at this RTC? Okay. Yeah.
You are very right in asking so real-time many market. Yeah, for the real-time market, particularly in a uncertain year, it is very difficult to tell you a trend. Internationally, we have seen this intraday market in a very different perspective. And you are very right in saying that this is the last resort for any of the utilities to buy power from the exchanges. Now, in last year, what has happened after June, there was a lull in the market, particularly in the prices, and both the day-ahead market and the RTM prices were much lower compared to the variable cost of most of the generators. If I can give you an example of Punjab, they have not utilized any of their generation for quite some time, and they resorted to buying from both the day-ahead market and the RTM market. This may not be the trend, but at the end of the day, the requirement of power is what you are driving getting the benefit from. Whether it is from RTM or day-ahead market, for a trader, supplying the quantum is more important. We are always ready to adapt ourselves for the requirement which comes from the utility, both buyers and sellers. So that we have done last year. And we would be retaining the similar kind of percentage of volume either in day-ahead market or RTM market or any other product, GTM market or any other product, keeping our customization possibility for the utilities.
Let me add on a slightly humorous mode. See, comparing us to the international market, the only problem is the Indian utilities. The government of India is trying to do that they have always one instrument, that is to switch off the power. So that is, till the time that thing is not sorted out, that you have to supply, and if you don't supply, you will be penalized. So it is in concept, but it has not been on paper it may be, or in concept. But once that is demonstrated, that no guy who is connected can be denied power. So Indian utilities have been using this last mile resort quite frequently. अरे आधा घंटा काट दो, ये कर दो, क्या अंतर पड़ जाएगा. लाइक बॉम्बे इज डिफरेंट, बॉम्बे इज डिफरेंट बिकॉज हाई राइज बिल्डिंग एक्सेट्रा, बट इन प्लेसेज अदर प्लेसेज 15 मिनट काट दिया, वो कर दिया, ये कर दिया. सो दे कीप डूइंग ऑल दिस टाइप ऑफ थिंग्स ऑल्सो. वन इज ऑन टेक्नोलॉजी, टेक्नोलॉजिकल प्रॉब्लम्स परफेक्टली दे हैव ऑल द राइट्स, बट नॉट ऑन कमर्शियल इश्यूज. सो कंपेयरिंग टू इंटरनेशनल इज गोइंग टू टेक सम टाइम, बट आई थिंक गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया इज रियली फोकस्ड. एंड जो एक है ना कहानी कही गई थी कि खिचड़ी जो है गर्म खिचड़ी में सीधे हाथ डालोगे तो हाथ जल जाएगा, तो खिचड़ी को साइड से हल्का हल्का खाना शुरू करोगे तभी जाके हाथ नहीं जलेगा. सो आई थिंक इट्स अ वेरी कॉशियस अप्रोच, इट्स अ टू एंड फ्रो, बट थिंग्स आर इम्प्रूविंग, थिंग्स आर चेंजिंग, बट इंडिया में थोड़ा समय लगता है. दैट्स ऑल आई कैन से.
थैंक यू मिस्टर मुच्छल, मे वी रिक्वेस्ट दैट यू रिटर्न टू द क्वेश्चन क्यू फॉर फॉलो अप क्वेश्चंस. थैंक यू. The next question is an audio and video question from the line of Rahul Modi from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead. Please accept the prompt on your screen and proceed with your question.
Hello. Thank you so much for the detailed discussion, sir. Just had two very broad questions again on macros. So we've seen, demand fluctuations due to COVID. We saw a very high demand base coming back in the fourth quarter, and again then we saw COVID coming in. So how do you see FY22, seeing how post slight relaxations have happened and the impact of that on short-term prices, and how the DISCOMs will behave going forward in terms of which products will be preferred in the broader market for us?
See, Dr. Mishra, please answer. Then, if required, then I'll do it.
Yeah.
Current year, he's asking Rahul, how the things.
Yeah. Yeah, Rahul, if we see this year, last 3 months, I mean, we are at the fag end of the third month. Our volume has gone up, and we are almost 20% up compared to the previous year. Of course, we have to. This quarter has to be over, and then we can tell you. With certainty, the demand is coming back to normal. Yes, there was a dip in the demand in the month of April and May. But since 15th of June, the demand is back to normal in most of the states. And particularly the prices, both in terms of the day ahead market prices and the RTM prices, are also back to more than normal. So we can say that from now onwards, if it no third wave comes, there can be a normal year from here. But of course, again, we can't predict keeping what has all happened in last 1.5 years. But we can safely say that the volumes till date has not been impacted because of the second wave for the company. As far as the mix is concerned, of course, the bilateral long-term, medium-term contracts are fully dispatched, and there is no fall in those volumes. Particularly, the cross-border also has started supplying to the maximum quantum. So on these fronts, we are comfortable. Short-term volume will always be meeting the last mile or the residual power which is required by the DISCOMs. And at this point of time, they are also less compared to what we have supplied previous year. So that's what I can tell at this point.
Rahul, I just wanted to add here what Dr. Mishra, just to supplement him, that other than the first quarter, whatever he has talked about, he also said in the beginning, when he was discussing a detailed presentation, that about 1,000 megawatt was formed up for the that medium term, that what is it is known as that.
Pilot two
scheme. So that is what is there, and more the prices are increasing, and the demand is increasing. He sees better traction. So that also will add to, other than the volumes, that is going to be a profitable proposition also. So depending upon how the third wave, see, we can't predict anything when and how it may come. It may not come. It may come for a longer period. Subject to those things not happening, we see a good traction, and we can see a normal growth in the overall business.
side of the business, which has been talked about. So what's your view? When do you see that coming in, and how can it be beneficial for a company like PTC? Thank you.
Sorry, which one? We couldn't hear his initial.
So the derivatives.
Dr. Mishra, if you can, if you got the questions completely, and if you can.
The derivative market is yet to come, as you know, because it is still in the Supreme Court, and the decision is yet to come. And once it is there, we have kept ourselves ready for any kind of a new product, such as derivative or futures. And as and when it comes, it will take some time to get operationalized, because these are legal hurdles at which it is right now. And after that, there are business rules and introduction of the product. So it may take some more time, but we are keeping ourselves ready for any kind of a new product whenever it comes.
Sure, sir. Thank you and all the best.
Thank you, Rahul. And one more thing I just wanted to add, what Dr. Mishra said, that the new exchange which is coming up, it has no legacies. So any type of new product, it is going to lap it up if it is permissible within the law and the regulations. That's all I can say.
Thank you. The next question is an audio and video question from the line of Rohit Natarajan from Antique Stock Broking. Please go ahead. Please accept the prompt on your screen and proceed with your question.
Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity. So my question is more to do with the embed. Question would be more, what exactly is the opportunity that we see? What will be the role of
sorry to interrupt in an embed you, Mr. Natarajan, world? The audio is breaking from your line, sir.
So can you hear me now?
Yes.
Now we can hear you, sir. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Again, no.
Mr. Natarajan, please turn off your video and proceed with your question. Mr. Natarajan, please rejoin the question queue. We'll take the next question. The next question is a text-only question from the line of Vivek Paldiwal, individual investor. Why does volumes is very high in Q2 only?
Dr. Mishra.
Yeah, actually, power is a seasonal commodity, and it is being consumed at different point of time, depending upon demand and supply. So, in the month of winter months, your demand comes down, and so is the supply because of the obvious reason. During the summer and Q2 period, summer and because of the high supply through hydro, you have both the demand and the supply also on a higher side. And this is a traditional trend, or rather this is a trend which we have seen last so many years, that we supply maximum during quarter two. It starts receding in quarter three, and quarter four is the lowest as far as the volume is concerned. But last year, there was, I said it is an aberration a little bit. So that's the reason why you may not find it comparable with the previous years, but still the quarter two was higher compared to the other quarters.
Thank you. The next question is a text-only question from the line of Danish Mistry from Investor First Advisors. We have seen a good reduction in receivables, rupees 924 crores, approx 150 days to 125 days outstanding. Reduction in debtors. Can we expect this to continue? If so, any sense on how much more? Thank you.
CFO.
I have already explained in the earlier question, the debtors for the March is rightly analyzed that it has reduced from 6,788 crore in the last March 20. And in this year, at the close of the year at March 21, it has come down to 5,836 crore. So there is a reduction in the debtor. But as far as the trend or making some projections that what will be the behavior of the debtors, I already explained that this depends on the capability of the DISCOMs, that how much collections they are able to do, how much they will pay to us, and that's all. But I can assure that we are managing our working capital. It not only dependent on the debtors per se, it dependent on the payment which we pay to the other generators also. So we always make a match of it, that in the ratio which we are receiving from the utilities, we are in that ratio only we are making to our generators. So we always, as already been pointed out in the earlier conversation, that for the last 2 years, we are maintaining our working capital of around 500 crore only. So from this, the pointer, you can very well gauge that it's always debtor and creditor we have to see simultaneously. So that the working capital should be in control, and our efforts always is to control that working capital in that fashion only.
Thank you. The next question is a text-only question from the line of Piyush Sood, private investor. Congratulations to PTC management on great set of numbers. Query 1. Can you please elaborate on the provisions created for PEL and other capital advances in the books of accounts? Thank you.
As I had stated earlier also, that our taking provision is a proactive and prudent step to account for the current business context. However, we are confident along with the rest of the developers in Andhra Pradesh especially, that the sanctity of the contract will be honored. So it's more of a prudent business practice which we have tried to follow. That's all.
Thank you. The next question is a text-only question from the line of AG, individual investor. Will PTC India need to dilute its shareholding in Pran Urja prior to the exchange getting operational, or can that be done subsequently? Thank you.
We believe we will do anything as per the regulatory norms. But Dr. Mishra, you want to add anything?
No, you are right in saying, sir, the PMR 21 or PMR 2010, whichever is applicable on the new exchange, will decide what we have to do.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, due to time constraint, we will take that as a last question. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Deepak Amitabh for closing comments.
I really thank every time we come back, and the investors' questions always energize us also. And many a times they have led into looking at the things in a much sharper and focused way. So I am always thankful to all the analysts and the investors who joined us for this conference, for this analyst conference, which we do on a quarterly basis. And we are looking forward to the year when there is no COVID, so that we can travel to Mumbai and meet each one of you physically. Now it looks like a real long-term dream, but we believe that till the time you don't dream, you don't achieve the thing. So we will keep dreaming of physically meeting and sitting with you all. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.